So let us continue with our lecture. Today we will start a new chapter, which means we will go one level deeper and do additional systematic developments. We will uncover a few more details on the mathematics of Feynman graphs and systematic methods to describe them with a very nice formalism. In fact, this formalism is powerful, but nevertheless rather simple, and you will see this today. We will probably prove 20 or 30 small theorems or statements which will be useful for our later studies of renormalization, but as you will see, they have a much more general usefulness. So before I go on, let me put here some acknowledgements. I mean, preparing this chapter and also some other chapters of this lecture here would not have been possible without the help of those collaborators here, which provided me with a magnificent set of internal notes and with many discussions helped me a lot in understanding all of these topics here, which we will discuss today and have already discussed in the last lectures and that we will also discuss in the future. So for this chapter, let us begin by looking at some quantum field theory Feynman diagrams. Here I drew three of them, and the mathematics of graphs that we will develop today means that we will go a little bit away from quantum field theory applications and look at the graphs in a more general sense. Because what do we have here? Here we have a Feynman graph with two external lines and two other vertices where there are no external momenta flowing into the graph. We will generalize this and allow that at each vertex of any graph there is always a momentum flowing into the graph. So this is a generalized way of looking at this. So we will actually put here some additional external momenta so that each vertex is treated in a uniform way, and the quantum field theory application would correspond to the special case that two vertices have zero external momenta. Similar here, we in quantum field theory, we get graphs with external lines where two external lines merge at one external vertex, and then for renormalization only the inner lines and the momenta of the internal propagators are important, and they depend only on the sum of these two external momenta. Therefore, what we will look at are graphs where at each vertex there is just one momentum flowing in instead of two, because that is pointless for our discussion. Finally, in quantum field theory, we have so-called tetpole graphs, where there are loop lines which just begin and end at the same vertex. And for renormalization, they are not very critical because they amount to some constants which depend on no external quantity. Therefore, they can be absorbed by adding a constant counterterm in a trivial way. And so it's not necessary to discuss them much further in the course of renormalization, and such graphs will from now on be ignored. So what that means is that we will look at new graphs which are characterized by vertices, and at each vertex we allow precisely one incoming momentum and we will not allow tetpoles. And this is the way we will treat the Feynman graphs throughout this entire chapter. Okay, so let us begin. The first subsection is on incidence matrices. incidence matrices and momenta. So let us first summarize in a technical way how we will now define and treat Feynman graphs. So as we already said, at each vertex, there is one incoming external momentum. And we will call these incoming external momenta as pi, and I runs from 1 to v. So v is the number of vertices of the Feynman diagram. Then at each internal line, we choose arbitrarily some direction, like this direction or that direction or this direction and so on. So we choose an arbitrary direction. And along that direction, we have an internal momentum. And let us call these internal momenta Lk for the lines, and k runs from 1 to capital I. So capital I is the number of internal lines in the Feynman diagram. Each line connects unambiguously two vertices, and the vertices are different because we do not allow tadpoles or we ignore them. Let's say a line k connects the vertex ik to the vertex fk. Now we can define an incidence matrix. An incidence matrix is defined as the matrix with components bik. So we have rows for each vertex and columns for each line. And the incidence matrix obviously denotes which line ends at which vertex. So the definition is including orientation plus 1, minus 1, or 0. So we have plus 1 where the lines end. Line k ends at vertex I, minus 1 where the lines begin. Line k begins at I, and otherwise, if no line, if line k is not attached to vertex I, then we get 0 in the incidence matrix. So let us give ourselves immediately some example. Let's take this Feynman graph here. Let me draw it a little bigger. So this is our famous two-loop Feynman diagram. And now, as we said, each vertex has an external momentum. So we draw now additionally those lines for the external momentum. And now let's give some arbitrary directions to each line. For example, this one, that one, this one, this one, and this direction. Then we give a name to each external vertex. 1, 2, 3, 4. And of course, we give a label to each internal line. Let's do it as we did it before. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have 5 internal lines, 4 vertices, and we have directions, and so we can now define the incidence matrix B for this Feynman graph. So the incidence matrix has a row for each vertex, therefore it has 4 rows. So here vertex 1 up to vertex 4, and it has 5 columns for line 1 up to line 5. Now let's fill in the incidence matrix. So let's do it line by line. Line 1, line 1 is this one, so it starts at 4 and ends at 3. That means we have here minus 1 and plus 1 at 4 and 3 and 0 else. Line 2 starts at 3 and ends at 4. Starts at 3 and ends at 4. Line 3 starts at 3 and ends at 1. Starts at 3 and ends at 1. So, like this. Line 4 starts at 2 and ends at 4. Starts at 2 and ends at 4. Line 5 starts at 1 and ends at 2. 1 and 2. Okay, this is the incidence matrix. This is how it looks like. So it's a matrix filled with zeros and ones. It is not a diagonal matrix, at least not in general. So in this case, it's a 4x5 matrix. And the rows and columns are filled with plus, minus, one, or zero. Now let us prove a few properties of such incidence matrices. Let me do it like this. So here, we will write down systematically the properties that we will prove. And here, we will do the actual proofs or comments on the properties. So the first thing that we can observe from looking at the matrix, if you go through any column, the numbers in each column add up to zero because each column means one line. So one line ends somewhere and begins somewhere. So each column must contain precisely one times minus one, one times plus one. So the sum in each column is zero. That means property A, the sum of the rows is zero. That means in equations, sum over I from 0 to V, 1 to V, BIK vanishes for all K. And the proof of A is therefore obvious by definition. But of course, what that means as a comment is the four lines here are not linearly independent. So this is property B. The rows are not linearly independent because, of course, the fourth row, for example, can be obtained as the sum of all the other rows. And so what that in particular means, so B is also obvious, and it follows that the rank of such an incidence matrix can be at most be as large as the number of rows minus 1. So the rank B is at most V minus 1. So we have this inequality for the rank, and that will be of interest later. So another consequence, which is property B, is that B is, of course, not invertible. Cannot be invertible if the rows are not linearly independent. So the next property, let us look at momenta. Look at the momenta into vertex I. Let's look at all the momenta into vertex I. So the momenta into any vertex arise from two sources. We have one external momentum flowing into each vertex, and then we have all the internal lines which are connected to the vertex. And given these arbitrary directions, we have here momentum L5 for the line 5. Here we have momentum L3 for line 3. So according to this direction, line 5 momentum flows out from the vertex. Line momentum L3 flows in. And here also the momentum P1 flows in by definition. So momentum conservation at vertex 1 would mean P1 plus L3 minus L5 is 0. And in general, this can be expressed using the incidence matrix as Pi plus sum over k from 0 to I over b I k lk is equal to 0, because this linear combination gives exactly all the line momenta from the internal lines flowing into the vertex. So this is also obvious from definition. So we have a nice mathematical way to express momentum conservation. Then, next, we can also look into position space. Position space, we can associate positions, space-time coordinates, yi for each vertex. Then in position space, what are actually the arguments of the position space propagators? So let's call it, let's say, delta k would be the propagator of line k, has the argument of the y for the final position minus y for the initial position, and that can be simply expressed as sum over I from 0 from 1 to v of b I k y I, and then you get here exactly the appropriate linear combination, the difference of the two y's which are associated with the line. So we can also nicely express in position space the arguments. So that is also obvious by definition. Now let us look at something more complicated, subgraphs. Let's look at a subgraph H, which is subgraph of our full graph G, not equal to the full graph G. Then how is the incidence matrix of the big graph related to the one of the small graph? So up to reordering, let's say you can always reorder such that the lines corresponding to the subgraphs are the first few lines, and the vertices of the subgraph are the first few vertices, and then the incidence matrix looks like this. B of the full graph is given as a block matrix. And here in the upper left block, you have the incidence matrix of the subgraph, B sub H. And here in the lower block, you have a zero. Here you have something. Let's say these are lines which are not contained in the subgraph, but corresponding to vertices in the subgraphs. Let's say other G lines connected to H. And here, in general, something non-zero. So this is the structure of the incidence matrix. Here you have a block corresponding to the incidence matrix of the subgraph. Here you have a zero block, and here you have two non-zero blocks as well. So let's say these are vertices outside of the subgraph, and these are lines outside the subgraph. So the question is, why is there a zero here? The zero here means that if you take vertices outside of the subgraph, then they cannot be connected to lines inside the subgraph, because the subgraph is always defined such that if any line is in the subgraph, then the vertices where the lines end are part of the subgraph as well. So by definition, a line in the subgraph cannot be attached to a vertex outside of the subgraph. That is why we have a zero here in this block. But the opposite is possible. Of course, you can have lines which are not in the subgraph, but outside, but which are connected to the subgraph. So for instance, the line number 4 is not part of the inner loop, but it's connected to it. So that would give a non-zero element here. So in that sense, this property E is also obvious by definition. Now let's do some development. Suppose you are given an incidence matrix which looks like this. It is a block matrix, and you have something non-zero here, and zero here, something non-zero here, and a zero here in the upper right block as well. So it almost looks like this, but the upper right corner is now zero too. What does that mean? It means that here you have the incidence matrix of a subgraph, and here you have zero, which means that there are no lines from the rest of the graph which are connected with this subgraph here. That means that subgraph is disconnected from the remaining graph. In other words, this kind of an incidence matrix describes overall a disconnected Feynman diagram with at least two independent disconnected components. So this describes a disconnected graph, and it's equivalent up to reordering. Of course, if you reorder the lines and vertices, then maybe it doesn't look like a block matrix, but if you have a disconnected diagram, you can always order the lines and vertices such that you get such a block matrix structure. So this describes a disconnected graph, and if you have a connected graph with a subgraph, then automatically you know that here you must have some non-zero elements. So let us now consider a connected diagram. So our big diagram is connected. If you have a connected diagram, then you can write down a chain of lines connecting any two vertices. So it exists a chain of lines connecting any two vertices. Let's say you start with vertex 1 and you want to connect it to vertex number n, then in a connected diagram this is possible, so you can find a set of lines which connect. So maybe there are at each vertex, there are some other lines attached to those vertices here. But anyway, you can find such a chain of lines. Up to reordering, let's say you can always call these vertices 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on up to n. And the lines you can call line 1, 2, 3, and so on up to n minus 1. So up to reordering, this is of course possible. So how does the incidence matrix look like if you have such a chain ordered in this nice way? Then the incidence matrix looks like this. So line number 1 starts at 1 and ends at 2. So you have here minus 1 plus 1 and 0 elsewhere. Line 2 starts at 2 and ends at 3. Line number 3 looks like this, and so on. And it goes on like this up to line number n minus 1 plus 1 somewhere down there. Therefore, you can now look at linear combinations of the columns of this incidence matrix. So if you, for example, add the first column to the second and then add the second column to the third and so on, and you always add one column to the next, then what do you get? So if you sum over these two columns, then the minus 1 plus 1 here drops out. Then also here the minus 1 plus 1 drops out. And what remains is always the minus 1 here from the left upper corner and the plus 1 from the last line you add. So if you do linear combinations of the columns for such a connected diagram, you can obtain linear co- combination of columns gives you any vector of the form minus one, then many zeros, and then somewhere a plus one. That means I'm running out of space here. Let me just delete this briefly. Just to make a long story short, linear combination of columns leads to vectors of this form, minus one in the beginning, then plus one anywhere, and zeros elsewhere. And these vectors span, of course, a V minus one dimensional space, because the minus one always stays, but the one here can be anywhere, and there are V minus one places where this plus one can be. So this spans a V minus one dimensional space. That means the vector space spanned by the columns is at least V minus one dimensional. That means the rank of the matrix is at least V minus one. Before we obtained the rank is at most V minus one. Therefore, we now know if we have a connected diagram, the rank is precisely V minus one. And that is our next property. If we have a connected diagram, rank B is exactly equal to V minus one. And in general, we have already seen that in general, the disconnected components give us block structures for the incidence matrix. And for each block, we will then have this appropriate formula. That means in general, the rank of the incidence matrix is V minus the number of connected components, V minus C. So this is our first set of properties of the incidence matrix, which is very useful. So after having established these first simple properties, let us go on and discuss the next step, which are reduced incidence matrices and independent vertices. So our sum rule A, the sum rule that the sum over all rows vanishes, means, of course, that one row is linearly dependent and therefore doesn't contain any new information. We can always reconstruct one of the columns from knowing all the other ones. So one, did I say one column? So one row. One row of the incidence matrix B can be dropped without losing information because we can always reconstruct it. The same is also true for the external momenta. So we have momentum conservation of the external momenta. Sum over I, Pi is equal to zero. So that is the same kind of sum rule over all vertices. Therefore, one external momentum can be dropped as well without losing information because we can always reconstruct the last external momentum from knowing all the other ones. And that means overall we can drop all the information from one vertex. Let's say vertex I0 is singled out, and we will drop the information for that one vertex and always reconstruct it from the remaining information. And that gives us a reduced incidence matrix. And we will call it small b, still with indices ik. And now I runs from 1 to v minus 1, so one row less than before, because we have dropped one vertex. So, and this is equal to b ik without our row number i0. Similarly, we can define an independent set of external momenta. And I will call this independent set Pi with an underscore. So Pi underscore is a set of V minus 1 external momenta. Again, I goes from 1 to V minus 1, and we have dropped Pi0. So this is a more minimal piece of information, and minimality is sometimes useful to obtain unambiguous equation. Of course, any of the vertices I0 can be chosen. And which choice we make is arbitrary, but after one choice has been made, it is fixed. So one additional thing we can investigate is how do the different choices differ from each other. Let us do it briefly and compare two different choices. One choice would give us one set of momenta, Pi underscore. Another choice would give us Pi prime underscore. So these are two different independent sets of external momenta. And likewise, we could obtain an incidence matrix small b or a reduced incidence matrix small b prime from dropping different vertices. For example, let us choose either dropping the vertex number 1 or dropping the vertex number 2. These are two different choices. So, and then in this case, our first set of momenta would be P underscore is the set P2, P3, and so on up to PV. We have dropped P1. The second set would be P prime underscore is P1, P3, so P2 is missing, and so on, up to PV. So the difference is in P1 and P2. So here, in this case, we know that P1 is given by minus P2, minus, and so on, up to minus PV. And so this is now the relationship. You can now write a matrix relation between the two. So P prime underscore is given by a matrix R times P underscore. And what are the elements of this matrix? So this matrix R is a matrix. And in the first line, so it should give us P1 by a matrix multiplication of this vector of momenta. And we have here the result. So this matrix must have -1, -1, and so on, -1 in the first line, so that multiplying that with this vector here gives in the first entry P1. And then the next momenta are all the same. So P3 is mapped to P3. So we have here a 1. P4 is mapped to P4, and so on. PV is mapped to PV. So this matrix is a triangular matrix. In the first line, it has all minus ones, and for the rest, it's just a unit matrix. Therefore, what we know about this matrix in particular is its determinant is plus or minus one. So in this case, it's minus one. But in general, if you do arbitrary things like this, the matrix will have determinant plus or minus one. So what we have learned from this is if you do different choices, then the choices differ by a matrix multiplication of such matrices which are have such a triangular form, at least after suitable reordering, and the determinant of the relative matrix is plus minus one. So, and similar to the momenta, you have the same relation between the reduced incidence matrices, of course, because they arise in exactly the same way. So our incidence matrix B prime with indices IK is given by matrix multiplication Rij times the other incidence matrix BJK. So it's the same rotation. Therefore, you have to make one choice, but all the choices that you can make are related in such a simple way, which is, again, useful to know. With that being said, let us prove another set of further properties. Let me remove the first set of simple properties. So the next property that I want to prove is if we, so first of all, let me say the properties that we are now going to prove have to do with not only incidence matrices, but how the incidence matrices describe momenta in Feynman diagrams. And the momenta, again, are related to three-level subdiagrams in Feynman diagrams, as we will now see. So let us begin with a connected three-level graph. Then we can prove that the incidence matrix small b is invertible. And this shows you that the reduced incidence matrix really is minimal in the sense of information content, since it's an invertible matrix. And it goes on. The next property, if you have internal lines, then the internal line momenta of a three-level graph are given by LK of line number K as minus the inverse b to the power minus 1 with indices ki times this independent set of external momenta pi underscore. Okay, so you have a direct relationship which gives you in a constructive way the internal momenta in terms of this minimal set of external momenta. So let's prove this. So if you have a tree graph, the tree graph has how many lines? It has zero loops, and that means the number of internal lines is equal to v minus one. So therefore, the reduced incidence matrix has v minus one rows, and since it also has v minus one lines, it is a square matrix. So v minus one square matrix. And so there is at least a chance that it is invertible. And of course, it has rank of B is equal to V minus 1. And that then shows that it is invertible. So that proves our property G. Then our momentum conservation, which was our property C from before, was that at each vertex Pi is plus the sum over k bik lk is zero. That was our momentum conservation. So if you drop one vertex, then you have here p underscore, here you have small b is invertible, so you can solve for the internal momenta Lk, and then you get this relationship here. So we have proven these two properties, but let us go on here on the right. Let us look at a general Feynman diagram, which is not tree level, but which might have loops. If we have, let me write it first here in a nice way. Let's look at a general connected graph. With loops, then we take a spanning tree capital T, and we use some standard momentum routing. As we defined some lectures ago, standard momentum routing means that all the lines outside of the spanning tree are set to explicit loop momenta K1, K2, and so on. And all the lines in the spanning tree, they are then given by linear combinations of loop momenta and external momenta. So that means Lk outside of the spanning tree set to loop momenta K1 to K capital L, and the other lines are determined by momentum conservation. Then up to reordering of the labels of lines and vertices, we can write our reduced incidence matrix in the following way. So our Feynman graph has now lines inside the spanning tree and lines outside the spanning tree, right? But a spanning tree contains all vertices of the Feynman graph. So we have here an incidence matrix which has one left block for the spanning tree and the right block for outside the spanning tree. So let's write it as B sub T. And we know that this is invertible, since that is the reduced incidence matrix of a tree graph, connected tree graph. And here we have the rest. Let's call it B sub loop. Then we have the following explicit relationship. Line momentum Lk is given by minus b for the spanning tree to the power minus 1 index ki times the independent momenta pi underscore plus this b sub loop with indices IL times loop momentum KL. So this is a nice explicit formula for all the internal line momenta in terms of the external momenta and the independent loop momenta K1 to KL in terms of these blocks of the reduced incidence matrix. And the proof is trivial because we just need to look once again at this relationship here and just write the momentum conservation at each vertex now in this block form. So we have the incidence matrix summation over all the lines inside the tree, which is then this B tree with indices IK, LK, plus the sum over all the lines outside of the tree, which where the incidence matrix is then this B sub loop index IK, and here the momenta are directly given by the loop momenta K sub K, and then you can solve for LK by multiplying with the inverse matrix here, and then you get this formula. Okay, so that is not very difficult, but you see how powerful this formalism actually is. The next step are subgraph aware momenta. So it's a strange way of calling things, but you will see what we mean by this. So let's consider a subgraph H, which is not equal to the full graph, and H and G should be connected for simplicity. Then let's look at the momentum variables after suitable reordering. So maybe here an example. Let's take a two-loop Feynman diagram like this for simplicity. So as we said, each vertex must have some external momentum. So it looks like this. And now let's take as a subgraph the left half of it. So this is now our subgraph. And we can compare it first, the full graph compared to the subgraph itself, and important for renormalization, to the reduced graph where the left subgraph is shrunk to a point. If the left subgraph is shrunk to a point, the diagram looks like this. This point has now three external lines corresponding to those external lines, and the graph is a one-loop graph that looks like this. So let's give it some names. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's now look at the momenta for all the involved graphs. For the full graph G, you have momenta P1 up to PV for each external vertex. For the subgraph H, you have a subset. Let's say after reordering, it's the first few vertices, P1 up to PVH for the number of vertices in the subgraph. Then question, what are the external momenta of the reduced graph? The external momenta of the reduced graph are now obtained in this way. The subgraph is shrunk to a point and the subgraph was connected. So the subgraph will be exactly one blob, and the incoming momenta into this blob are the sum of all the incoming momenta into the subgraph. So our reduced graph has as at the blob the external momentum P1 plus and so on up to plus PVH. And then the reduced graph has all the external vertices of the remaining graph G, so comma PVH plus 1 and so on up to PV. Okay? So there is one overlap between the external momenta of the reduced graph and of the subgraph. Now, what is a possible choice of the independent momenta if we take into consideration momentum conservation? So a possible choice, which is very simple, is if we remove this vertex here, PVH, and in the reduced graph, we can remove this complicated vertex with the sum of all the external momenta. And also in the full graph, we can remove this vertex PVH. Then we have done something instant and very simple, because then what remains are just single variables for all the three involved graphs. So one possible choice of the external momenta is exactly this one. So for G, we choose everything P1 except for PVH, PV, and that would form what we call P underscore. For the subgraph H, we choose P1 up to PVH minus 1. So we also remove PVH. And that would give us a set of variables that I call Q sub H. So it's variables Q specific to our subgraph H, an independent set of variables corresponding to our subgraph H. And for the reduced graph, G divided by H, we choose those momenta here which start at PVH plus 1 up to PV. And that would give us a set of variables that I call QG. So for simplicity, I call it QG, not QG over H. I will explain the notation in a little bit more detail also later. But now we have three sets of momentum variables, P, Q sub H, Q sub G. And of course, the union of these two variables forms something that I call Q, and the union Q contains exactly the same variables as this original independent set P for the original graph. So what have we done? The simplest, which is this case, gives us the following structure. We have in our original graph an independent set of momenta P, and at the end we get an independent set of subgraph-aware variables. Namely, we have a set of variables Q, which is split into one block for the subgraph and another block for the reduced graph. And those two sets of variables are connected again by a matrix R, which in this case is R equal the unit matrix. So, now what happens if you choose other variables in all these three graphs? So if you choose, for example, in the full graph, you might choose not to remove this PVH, but you remove some other vertex. But in the subgraphs, you do what you do here. Then it changes in the same way as we calculated some minutes ago. You get a matrix which is not a unit matrix, but which is a triangular matrix up to reordering with some minus ones in certain lines. But that matrix will then still have determinant equal to plus minus one. Or if you choose other variables in the subgraph or in the reduced graph, it is the same thing. You can always relate Q to whatever you choose as P by a matrix which has determinant plus or minus one. So the reason is as above in our calculation that we did 10 minutes ago. And so from this discussion, we learn something which I will call property J, and I will write it down in explicit form. There is no other need to prove it. We will just directly follow it from this example. So the property that we can read off from this discussion is property J. The following: consider a connected graph G and a full forest of this of this graph G. So, in other words, a set of non-overlapping subgraphs. Are also one particle irreducible, but that is not important here. But it's a full forest, so it includes the full graph G itself. And if we do that, so it's here we have such a situation with just one subgraph, but we could have several nested or disjoint subgraphs and do the same procedure. So we can find independent momentum variables of the following form. So first, independent momentum variables P for the full graph and independent variables Q, which are subgraph aware which have the following properties. So first of all, Q is given by a matrix R times P, where the determinant of the matrix R is plus minus 1, like before. And this set Q is partitioned into the individual blocks corresponding to subgraphs. So Q subgraph H1, Q subgraph H2, and so on, up to Q for the full graph G, where Q for any of those subgraphs or for the full graph contains only variables of this specific subgraph, but not only that, subgraph divided by the maximal subgraph of it, which exists in the forest. Okay, that is exactly what we did here. So that explains my notation Q sub G. So Q sub G does not contain all the momenta of the graph G, but it contains only those momenta of G reduced by the maximal subgraph which we have, which is in this case G reduced by H. So only those variables are allowed inside this Q sub G. And that means we get a partition. So if you have nested or disjoint subgraphs, you can do the same procedure, of course. So if you have disjoint subgraphs, you do what we did here for the two disjoint subgraphs separately. There is no interference at all. If you have nested subgraphs, so you have yet another subgraph which lies inside of H, then you just go on and do the same for the nesting. So clearly, this property is established. And so you can redefine your momentum variables in such a way so that if you have a forest, you have nice momentum variables specific for all the subgraphs and all the reduced graphs in the forest. Now let us directly jump to the next property and write it down. Afterwards, we will prove it. Property K. Property K is, let's consider again a subgraph H, which is not equal to the full graph, and H and G are connected. Then, after appropriate reordering, the reduced incidence matrix for the full graph has a block form. And here in the upper left block, we have the reduced incidence matrix for the subgraph. Here we have something, let's call it B sub HG. Here we have zero. And here we have the reduced incidence matrix of the reduced graph G over H. And an obvious generalization holds for a full forest of G. So if you have not one subgraph, but many disjoint or nested subgraphs, you can go on and have a block structure for the full incidence matrix for each block of all these nested or disjoint subgraphs. Okay, what is the non-trivial thing of this? So before we already had a property for the normal incidence matrix without reducing. And then we said we have a zero here. So the zero is clear. It's already clearly established from before because for any subgraph of any incidence matrix, we have a zero here. And we said we have non-zero in general here. We have the incidence matrix of the subgraph here. That was also clear. But the fact that we have here the incidence matrix of the reduced graph, that is the new thing that we should look at. So how can we prove that? So start with a full incidence matrix without a reduction of the full graph. And also look at the full incidence matrix of the subgraph. Now let's, from both, we need to remove one vertex. And let's choose to remove one vertex which lies in the intersection, so out of the subgraph H. If we do that, then we get automatically from our previous theorem this structure here of the reduced incidence matrix of the subgraph. Now, how do we obtain actually the full incidence matrix of the reduced Feynman diagram? We obtain it by taking the full incidence matrix and contracting all the lines of the subgraph into one point. And in terms of incidence matrix, it just means that we sum over all the columns corresponding to the lines in the subgraph. So we, let's say, remove lines 1 up to IH and contracting vertices 1 up to VH and that means the first column of our BG over H is equal to the sum of I equal to from 1 to VH of BG comma IK. So all these vertices which are in the subgraph are summed over. Any line which ends at one of them is uniformly treated as ending at one single vertex, which is the first vertex of the reduced graph. So that is the simple formula to obtain the reduced the incidence matrix of the reduced graph. And so that means the first column of this is now special, but all the other columns which correspond to the vertices outside of the reduced graph, they are the same as the columns for the original graph. And so if we reduce it, BG over H can be obtained by dropping the first column of this full incidence matrix. And if we drop the first column from this, which was special, then all the other columns remain, and those just are equal to the columns of the original incidence matrix. Therefore, this proves our property K. Okay, so let us frame this. This is yet another important property. So in terms of the reduced incidence matrix, we see yet another advantage because then our incidence matrices have this block structure that here appears the incidence matrix of the reduced graph, which is not the case for the full incidence matrices. Okay, so that is very nice.